One second. Okay. Well, hi, Richard. Thanks for joining me on Practicing Well.
Thanks for asking me to come on.
I'm so glad to see you after so many years.
How long has it been? A long time.
Yeah, I think it's been like 20 years, 2019 or 20 years. And, you know,
time really flies.
What's that?
Time really flies when you're having fun.
Time really flies when you're having fun and when you're not, probably. I think it flies regardless. It bends in any event. But, you know, your teaching made an indelible impact on my own teaching, my own thinking about yoga practice, and especially about the breath and about pranayama. I was early on in my career when we first met and you taught me, and these two decades later, I still think a lot about some of the teachings that came from you to me and of course went on to my students. And it of course makes me think about the conversations I've had on this podcast with teachers like you who have that kind of effect on students and who also are coming from a couple of different places, not just the Iyengar yoga tradition, but other traditions as well. And I thought we could start with how you arrived into the yoga classroom, the basic journey question, but I'd love to know, because I never did get to ask you way back when.
I was living in Oakland, California, and I had just broken up with a girlfriend, and I was feeling sorry for myself, as people do when that happens. And I recall the book that I'd read when I was in grad school called Think on These Things or something like that by Krishnamurti. And at the time, which was in the late 70s, I had no idea what he was talking about. And I think I did really poorly on the test. But I finally found an apartment for myself, and I was sitting there feeling sorry for myself. And I remembered something about this book when I was just, you know, pondering over my life. And I picked up the book, and it didn't make complete sense, but it made more sense. And that's really started me looking for other books like that. And I scoured bookstores as I want to do. I always buy a lot of books. And I found this book by Robert DeRopp called The Master Game. And in it, he said something about yoga being the best exercise ever invented, something like that. So I thought, okay. And then I got a local paper, and by some coincidence, there was an ad in there for the yoga room, which was in Berkeley, which was down the street, a couple of miles. So I thought, all right, I'll go. And I did. This was in May 1980. And that was it. I actually started going regularly to classes down there.
And the yoga room was what I feel like Andrea Ferretti may have mentioned the studio as well last week when I talked to her. What was the lineage of yoga room, or what teachers were there?
It was Iyengar, totally Iyengar. And Donald Moyer was the director at that time, the late Donald Moyer, R.I.P. Yeah. I took classes with him for many years.
Wow. And so your first exposure, and you know, I'm thinking about, you know, Judith Lassiter's come on, and Jason Crandall's come on, and a few people and Rodney, you know, who have talked about yoga in the Bay Area in the 80s, the 90s, and what a really potent time that was for yoga. Did you experience that? Because
it was a hotbed. At that time, I mean, right, there were very few studios. I think there were two in Berkeley or in the East Bay. And not that many in San Francisco either. And I was going to the Iyengar Institute there. So, but people came from all over the world to get the training for the Iyengar training. It was a 2-year training in those days. So there were people from Japan and Germany and all over.
Yeah. And that's really where the locus was. And I think I have heard some people talk about East Coast Iyengar yoga at that time and Bay Area. Well, or maybe it's Bay Area and LA, but that's kind of those three areas were the places where most of the studying was taking place in the early days of Iyengar yoga. Is that right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so you, did you then decide to take that teacher training and become an Iyengar yoga teacher? I did miss that thread. I don't know actually.
I have no idea why I started that training. I have completely forgotten. But I started in 1982. And it was a two-year program in those days. So it took me 2.5 years to get through it, I think. But I've racked my memory for why I went. I just don't remember. But that's where I met Rodney for the first time.
Mm-hmm. And so you then became an Iyengar yoga teacher. How long did you stay with that methodology?
I wasn't really formally Iyengar teacher. I was Iyengar influenced, but I was never certified. Mm-hmm. So I really couldn't call myself an Iyengar teacher.
That was the
extent of my training Iyengar.
I see. But, well, what happened after that then? Where'd you go and who did you, I mean, the Krishnamurti, I too was very influenced by Think on These Things. Maybe it started with you, but I feel like it came from Eric Schiffman.
Probably.
Yeah. And I've passed that book on and taught it myself because it's a really existential exploration of presence and being in the present moment. I remember it so much. And I still think about this particular section of one of his speeches where he said, just wake up every day and try to look at everybody like you're just meeting them for the first time. Like, look at a bird, look at a blade of grass, look at the sky like you've really never seen that detail or been in relationship to that thing. And it certainly has always been helpful for me in terms of yoga practice, because I feel like if I'm ever doing a pose or doing a practice, I mean, pranayama never, ever feels the same. I don't think I've ever felt that way. But in other cases, if I feel like it's the same experience, I know there's some thickness in my mind, or there's some, but something's happening that's preventing me from actually being in that moment with the pose, because it's by definition so different. Is that, you know, you mentioned Krishnamurti first. So is that the thread that kept pulling you through and into your teaching? So what, if you didn't become certified as an Iyengar yoga teacher, what then made you decide to become a yoga teacher?
Rodney forced me. Rodney was the one that thought of opening a yoga school. He always has great ambitions, and he, you know, so, this was in 1987 when we opened the Piedmont Yoga Studio. That was in Oakland. And it was only the second or maybe the third or fourth studio in the East Bay at that time still. I had been teaching before then periodically, but nothing regular. And that's when I started teaching regular in 1987.
And what was that like? I mean, did you feel prepared? Did you feel good about it?
No. I would follow Rodney on Tuesday night, see? And Rodney is the perfect yoga teacher, in my opinion. I mean, he's got everything you need. And he had classes, it was a fairly small room. I didn't remember how many square feet it was, but it wasn't large. And he had so many people in the room, they could barely breathe anymore. They're sucking up all the oxygen. And then I'd come in right after him after that with about three students. And it was quite an interesting contrast.
Barbara Baina and John Schumacher were on. They just released their podcast today, and they were talking about their early days of teaching and how if three people came to class, they were psyched. I mean, they were so happy. So Rodney's, as we discussed before we clicked record, he's unusual. And
Before we opened the studio, Rod lived in Oakland, and he had a big dining room. He was going out of town one week, and he asked me to teach for him there. So I went to his house, his apartment, to do the teaching, and I thought, you know, a few people would be there. The room was packed. I mean, he's a yoga attractor, and people just love him.
Yeah, I mean, he, you know, thinking back to the way the two of you taught in concert with each other in this program where I met you both. Well, I met Rodney before I went out there because of him. He's just metaphoric, you know, he really kind of, you know, creates these moments in time that, to your point, sort of fill the space.
He wears his heart on his sleeve.
He does.
He comes out with the most incredible things. Sometimes they're not exactly true, but they sound good anyway.
and they feel good. And it, and yeah, it exactly. takes people to play. I mean, it, it is, I mean, I keep saying this, but you know, his book, The Poetry of the Body, I was also very influential on me. And just like when you're sitting there, listening to someone read poetry or reading a book of poetry yourself, you know, you are bringing to bear your own experiences to that art, which is why the poetry exists. I mean, you stitch experience into reality with poetic lines, much obviously more skillfully than you do by just by exposition, you know, just by talking about things. But you ultimately found your groove, I suppose, at that time with Yoga of the Breath. What, I mean, it's a great book and so well organized, as I, you know, emailed you about.
I had good editors.
Yeah. I mean, did you think about creating that those four parts to begin with? Or
yeah,
let's just talk about the book. Yeah.
I don't know about it to begin with, but those are my thoughts.
Mm-hmm. And what made you want to write about the breath versus about, I don't know, walking down the street or doing yoga on a Ferris wheel, or, you know, what, why the breath?
I was asked to write the book by a publisher that I won't name, and it didn't work out, unfortunately. Hmm. And I won't go into the details of that, but so I was pretty disappointed when she said she didn't want to continue. Hmm. So I called up a good friend of mine, Georg Furstein, who I'm sure you know about. Right. And I said, Georg, what am I going to do now? And he said, don't worry about it. He got a hold of Shambhala and they had a contract within a week.
That's amazing. I mean, it was one of the first. I mean, I think to me, this part of, I mean, there's multiple parts of the conversation I'm really interested in getting into with you, but this part is so interesting from a kind of cultural, intellectual perspective, because tons of books are now just dropping every other day about the value of the breath, like why the breath, yoga and the breath. So let's talk about what you think you were doing with that book, what your hope for it was. I mean, did you have an audience in mind when you wrote it, or?
Well, I usually write my books for a general audience. I'm trying to keep them as simple as possible. And it was sort of like an easy light on yoga or light on pranayama.
Totally. Totally. And that's why light on pranayama is so good, but it's so hard and it's so dense, because by the time you get to the, you know, like I just have the Ujjayi, you know, and Viloma sections, well, all of the how-to sections toward the end of the book, you know, earmarked basically. I mean, I had to read a bunch of that book to get certified in Iyengar yoga, you know, in 2018, I guess it was, but to teach it and also to even do it myself. Sometimes it's just like so much of Iyengar's work that when you read it, you realize there is no way I'm going to memorize this. There's just, I need to just keep reading it, because every day I read it, there's one word or one phrase or one something that sticks out. And I'm pretty sure I'm dyed in the wool yoga. I mean, I'm pretty sure I'm not the general audience.
Yeah.
So when you wrote about, you know, clarification and cooperation of the breath, what were you talking about and what do you think is going on there now?
Clarification comes from a word that means to be clear. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the first step. Mm-hmm. One of my teachers said that, Ramanand Patel actually said that before you change anything about yourself, you have to know yourself and know what you do before you try to change what you're doing. So that was my first step, is just find out who you are as a breather.
Mm-hmm.
And then cooperation is, I've never really liked the idea of calling pranayama breath control. I don't think that's a good way of looking at it. Mm-hmm. So I thought of it more as being in cooperation with your breath. Yeah. Your breath has a mind of its own, and if you try to control it, who's doing the controlling? You know, if you're controlling from your brain, your brain's part of the problem with breathing.
Totally.
I just decided to just watch my breath and see what it wanted to do first before I started to change it.
Mm-hmm. How long do you think it takes? It takes everybody a different amount of time, doesn't it?
Yeah,
different,
of course.
Yeah, depth and everything. Because sometimes I feel like I've made, progress is just not a word I also would use with pranayama either.
No.
Right?
No. Mr. Iyengar's schedule in the backup line on pranayama is really unrealistic. Yeah. It ain't going to happen that way.
Right.
It takes a long time. One of my teachers called it mule work. Just got to do it day after day and not think about it that much.
Yeah. Right.
So, yeah.
Yeah. Because I feel like if I, whatever explorations or understandings I may make, it just never feels like it's that solid. I mean, the breath isn't solid anyway. So I guess it's never going to feel that solid, but it just really does feel like it's always a new experience, and you can tether yourself to these rhythms of practice, like prolonging the exhale, prolonging the inhale, interrupting both, you doing it supine, doing it seated. Nearly all the people on this podcast in the audience are either longtime yoga practitioners or teachers. And I'm certain that they are relating to this conversation about how much work it takes to breathe or to look at your breath, to practice, to cooperate with your breath, other than the cooperation and the comprehension that you talk about in the book. Is there anything else you would describe or offer as guidance today after 20 years since you wrote the book?
I don't remember. I always think of what Mr. Iyengar says, that your practice waxes and wanes like the moon. Mm-hmm. So sometimes you're waxing and sometimes you're waning. And, that's just the way it goes. And it's not a bad thing entirely when you're waning. It oftentimes means that you're breaking down these old patterns and you're getting ready to install new ones, new, more improved patterns.
Mm-hmm. Improved patterns.
Healthy patterns, I guess. I don't know.
Yeah, I know. Improvement makes it all. Yeah, I hear that. And I start feeling a little stressed out. I try to improve so many other aspects. I sometimes just want to go into the breath and see it and be with it.
Yeah. You don't want to have a goal. You just want to do it day by day and just let it happen.
Totally. I mean, so from my point of view, that book is, I love hearing that you wrote it for a general audience, because that's, to me, the way it reads and the way that I think lots of people could take it in. And now, how do you feel today about so many of these books written for general audiences, like James Nestor's book? Like, there's just another.
James Nestor was an interesting book.
Yeah. What do you think about it?
About James Nestor?
No, about the book.
Books in general?
No, his book. These breathing books. It's sort of, do you agree, I guess, or do you see or experience that there is this kind of wave of breathing books and breathing knowledge and breathing info that's sort of out there that people are trying to get a handle on in a way that I've never seen?
Yeah, well, there are. I have a lot of books on breathing in my yoga library. I'm not really sure what to say about them. They're on a range of value. Mm-hmm. But in general, I think people want to go too fast. I think we Westerners want to see results for our efforts, and we don't like to do things that we don't feel like we're getting something out of it. And that's the problem. That's one of the big problems. I give some advice to people, to yoga teachers out there, prospective yoga teachers. Don't get pranayama as your niche practice, because it's not very popular even now.
Yeah.
What's the word I'm looking for? I don't know what to say. It's it just takes a long time. I mean, mm-hmm. you can touch your toes after a few asana classes, and you know that's a good part icebreaker at a party. But you can't say you don't watch me breathe or something like that.
It just
comes and goes, and the other problem is that it brings up things that may not be pleasant to feel.
Right.
And that happens fairly often.
Yeah.
So it can be a very disturbing practice at times.
Mm-hmm.
I remember when I lived in Oakland many years ago and I was practicing pranayama in the morning, I would have headaches and irritability. I went through a long period of, I was just fighting myself because of the breath. And I finally figured out that I was being too aggressive.
Mm-hmm.
And then I had to back off.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, that helped.
Do you have to be sort of, I don't know if a fearless is the right word, or is it courageous? Because
I think curious is a good word.
Yeah.
I think that's the central emotion of the universe, I guess, is being curious about yourself.
Totally. And you can use the breath as a way. It's funny. Students over the years have asked me, and earlier on, I don't hear it as much anymore, but what's the difference between meditation and breath cooperation, breath control? And I always find it so hard to describe the difference because they're so massively other than each other. I mean, how do you, do you get asked that question? Do you, in your mind, describe your own difference between the two?
I guess it depends on what school of yoga you follow. You know, for in Patanjali yoga, breathing is a preparation for meditation.
Mm-hmm.
But I think in general, for me, the breath and meditation come together. They go together. Mm-hmm. I use my breathing as a means of establishing a witness that follows me around all day, looking over my shoulder, watching what I say and do and think. I found that to be very useful because you're breathing all the time. So you can always step back and reestablish that contact with your witness.
Mm-hmm. Totally. It's funny. My daughter, she probably would not like me saying this, but it's really worth it because out there in parent land, you know, parent mindful land, you know, it's like, you know, just breathe with your child and, you know, sit down and have deep, long breaths. And my daughter, when she was younger,
player?
Yeah, exactly. The soccer player. So I would get early. I would, you know, but yeah, you know, let's just take a breather. Let's take some breaths. And she'd go, and she would just start like breathing so hard and so aggressively. And it was just, it always be so funny to me. Cause I was like, this is the perfect gift that she's giving me as a yoga teacher, because there's no chance I'm going to get her to calm down by using the breath. It just
not at a young age anyway.
Exactly. It may at some point, but she just doesn't trend that way. She needs to do a handstand to calm down. She needs
kids
to
want to be active.
Yeah. Yeah. And so anyway, I just, it's been such a journey even as a parent to integrate these learnings into my own, you know, pranayama practice, because it just always makes me laugh so much. Well, that's not, we're not going to calm down that way.
My wife convinced me when she was pregnant, she goes to a psychic every now and then. She convinced me to walk one time and I thought, all right. But the psychic told me when my wife was pregnant that the guru was about to be awakened.
Yeah, well.
When my daughter was born. It's sort of true. I mean, I learned a lot about myself from her.
Oh my God. Totally. I mean, I'm sure it still continues, right?
More than ever.
Yeah, she's exactly.
She's 30 now.
And, that's great.
She wants to. She wants me to live forever, so she's controlling everything I do to make sure I do live forever.
Yeah, I really. It's funny. I just texted my dad the image of this like walker. He had polio when he was young, and so it's ravaging him now in his late 70s. Yeah. It's one of the reasons I teach yoga, actually, because I stared at his spine growing up, and it was, you know, they in the late 40s, you know, when he had it, he didn't walk for 6 years from five. He got it at six and he finally was able to walk again when he was 11, because they figured out, they shaved off a little, like a shard of his femur. And they stuck it up. They stuck it up his T-spine, which is what had melted from the polio.
Yeah.
And they reconstructed his foot, which also had kind of melted away. And he was upright once again, because they figured out how to take one of his own, a portion of one of his longest bone, and shunt and be basically make it be the brace. But anyway, he's obviously, like, his spinal column now is like kind of twisting off of the sacrum, because they couldn't really stop the twist. They could get him upright, but they couldn't. So anyway, I texted him and like the image of a walker that I saw where he could put his elbows on it, you know, and he texts back like, I'm good. I got it. I'm all right. I got these two things. So I relate to your daughters. I'm saying that it's hard because it's attachment and we want to help. And I wonder if, you know, this is a good intro or in entree or whatever into talking to you about your Parkinson's, because this has been something you've been working with for years now, using yoga to work with. And I do think that for this podcast, it's one of the first that we will have had of a yoga person, a yogi, a yoga teacher, a longtime yoga practitioner discuss, you know, a disease state, a state of, you know, activity of the mind-body complex that you may or may not be using yoga successfully to manage. I don't know about that. And I'm just fascinated to learn.
Well, I don't call it a disease, I call it a condition that makes it sound a little bit better.
Fair enough.
Well, I've been very fortunate. I've had it for 20. I've been diagnosed for 21 years. I probably had it a few years before then. Mm-hmm. Yoga, asana, I should say, not yoga, but asana, is helpful. It's not a cure-all by any means. But especially breathing is very useful, because one of the side effects of a Parkinson's is anxiety. Mm. And I went to anxiety and depression. And the funny thing is, I went to a psychiatrist for the depression, and she was a medical doctor as well. And she gave me pills to take, and I went to the pharmacy to get the pills. And while I was there, I decided to treat myself to a chocolate bar. And I got that to the counter with the pills. And the chocolate bar cost more than the pills.
Oh, it was
good chocolate. But I thought to myself, they're just dispensing these things like candy. I thought of THX 1138, that movie by, anyway, never mind about that. Anyway, I got home and I dumped the pills out in the toilet. I started breathing. And the slowing the breath and waiting for the breath to come back is a really effective way to almost always calm down the anxiety. Mm-hmm. So you know, in that respect, my yoga practice was very one of the things is I when I was diagnosed with yoga with Parkinson's,
if only we could all be diagnosed with yoga, that would be awesome.
I'd been a practitioner for 21 years or 22 years already, and I had an advantage over other people who developed Parkinson's later in life, and that is I knew my body really well by then.
Yeah,
I could find things in my body that, you know, the average person has no idea where they are.
Right.
So I could pretend to be normal if I thought about it. So it was turned into like a meditation when I was walking down the street, or I don't know, just sitting. I would purposely walk normally. And that was one of the things that yoga really helped me do. But you know, now that the condition is progressing, and you can hear me stuttering a little bit and losing my words, my balance is really off too. So I have to really be careful now when I walk down the street.
Mm-hmm. And do you? I'm just thinking specific. Do you do asymmetric poses? I had a teacher training once who worked with people with Parkinson's. And so she would often, you know, do like tree pose against the wall, for example. Are there, I mean, you're to your point about knowing so much more about your body, you may be beyond, you know, just applying tree pose to your right, left side or balance. But do you have any specific postural things you do to manage the balance?
Well, I practice in the evenings usually, and I just work on the basics, the groins, the side torso, the chest, the opening the chest, because I spend a lot of time in front of the computer, hunched over, so I have to watch my back. Yeah. It's a lot of lying around now rather than being more active because the balance is off.
Right.
But I use a chair when I need to balance, and it's hard for me to do inversions now. I have a headstand to use, and I use a pole. I don't know if you know how to do that, but you take a pole for shoulder stand and you sort of screw it into your back to get the chest to open up. Mm-hmm. So I've made a good use of props, and I that's really helpful for me as a teacher, because now I'm one of the things I think I'm really good at as a teacher is using props.
My memory is you were so good at using props. In fact, I can remember this work upper trapezius stabilizing that we did with you on a chair, like tons of us in a room. And there were fortunately at Piedmont Yoga Studio enough chairs. And I still teach that today, or, you know, do it with myself. So I don't know. I think you probably were down the prop rabbit hole early on. Do you see anybody, any other yoga teacher, like colleagues or anybody out there who has worked with other people with Parkinson's?
A yoga friend of mine, Vicky Bell, Vicky Bell does a lot of work with Parkinson's. I actually started that class years ago, and it just got to be too heavy for me. So I gave it to her. She took it over without really knowing anything about Parkinson's, and she's really, you know, she's made it into a really interesting, useful program for people with Parkinson's. Mm-hmm. So I would say if you need somebody to talk to about Parkinson's, she would be the one to contact.
Yeah, that would be great. I'm sure there will be people who will contact her about that. So I wanted to ask about the pausing in the breath. Do you find that the pausing and waiting for the breath to return at the end of the exhale is what is quieting most for the anxiety?
Absolutely. And
The pause is
stillness and silence. It's a movie screen, actually, and the breath is projected onto the screen. Mm-hmm. So no matter what the breath is, the screen is always there. It's always the same. It's always white and blank, like in a movie theater, and also inhalations are stimulating half of the breath. So when I wait for the breath, it usually takes, I don't know, 5 or 10 or 15 seconds. But there comes a point where the breath just wants to come in, and so I take it in with a minimum amount of effort, and that sort of vitiates the stimulus of the inhalation, and then the exhalation is very long and slow, and that's the calming breath. So I do that. I teach pranayama, well, breathing anyway, in all my classes, all my public classes, for 15 minutes at the end.
Yeah,
and that's the first thing the first thing we start to do always is bring ourselves to ourselves. Just look at ourselves.
Right, right.
Get centered in yourself, and then we do the slow breathing with the pause at the end.
Mm-hmm. With the pause at the end.
Yeah.
Do you ever do the pause at the top at the end of the inhale?
Not with beginners. I mean, we'll pause. I won't do retention, but we'll pause for 2 or 3 counts.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And are you teaching them in the sort of standard? I mean, do you have them supine? Do you have them on blankets so their chest is open?
It's optional. Some of them like to. I've had some students now for, I don't know, 15, 20 years. So
yeah,
it's optional. I give the option at the start of the practice. You can lie down, and I show them how to make a support, or you can sit up. It's totally optional. And most people lie down, but there's a few sitters.
Yeah, a few sitters. I mean, it's It's big work to sit and to follow your
breath.
I mean, it's, I don't know if sitting against the wall, I'm not sure that's usually the progression that I was taught, you know, supine against the wall, seated. And then in the middle of the room, if you so dare, which sounds a little challenging. I don't mean for it to sound that way. It's just that it's deep to breathe like that. And without, you know, sometimes I do it in the mornings and it's always dark. And so, and I start supine and then sit.
Yeah. And
I don't know. There's just something about like the vastness of the space, like in front to the sides and behind you. There's so much. And it usually feels comforting to be enclosed in that much space, but it still feels really big and really vast. And you're obviously just the small parts of the musculature that have to be ready to take on that. So you're still teaching after these many years so you've been teaching now for what?
36 years.
And are you finding with your condition that teaching is a steady act, or have you had to pull back, or how do you manage?
I've had to pull back in giving talks. Mm-hmm. My memory is not good anymore. I put my keys down 5 minutes later. I can't find them. Mm-hmm. And I have a hard time giving. I can answer questions all day. So if somebody wants me to give a talk, I say, well, you have to give me some questions and I'll answer the questions.
Right.
But if I have to give a talk off the top of my head, that's very difficult for me right now. Mm-hmm. I can't remember what I need notes. If I don't have any notes, I'm in trouble. Mm-hmm. So that's one thing. I've turned down a couple of opportunities to do trainings in history of yoga and whatnot. But I still teach my regular classes. It's nothing's changed there.
Right. I was taught when I talked to Barbara Bainon, John last week, was it? Yeah. My conversation was 2 weeks ago, I guess. And I just released the conversation today, and I was asking them what has changed in their teaching, if their intentions have changed, if their approach has changed. And they really, neither of them said that much had changed, except that their practices have changed. And John was saying, you know, I keep finding that what I'm really focusing on now is becoming quiet and present, teaching the students to be quiet and present. And Barbara had a little bit of a physical kind of description, just that her actual postures have changed and morphed over time, but she didn't, well, and she's only teaching like a couple times a month, not much, but how would you say, I know, well, how, yeah. Well, how would you say that your teaching has changed, and has Parkinson's informed the way you teach like a general population as well?
I that's hard to say. I don't know. I've never thought of that before, but I certainly, I'm not quite as Iyengar as I used to be. You know, I don't insist on people doing things the Iyengar way. If they're doing, if somebody's rounded forward in a forward bend, as long as you're not killing your back. I just, when I first started teaching, I was very, very strict. But now I let people have their own way, unless it's really dangerous or unless they can improve what they're doing easily. I try to make my classes suit the students that come to me now. I have a lot older students. I get a few younger ones every now and then, but they're mostly older. You have to be careful with those folks and not really push them that hard. But, it's amazing. I've got 76-year-old female students who are still doing handstands.
Yeah.
That just makes me really amazing.
Yeah. Yes. And, so are they all, it's funny, I guess, God, what did you do during COVID? Did you teach online?
Online. Yeah.
Yeah. Like the rest of us.
That's fun.
Ugh. I mean, I don't know. I try, hope springs eternal. And I was like, well, and have said, many times that people with social anxiety and people who, for all kinds of reasons, were not able, especially working parents, for example, to take that 20, 25, 30 minute commute to the pay for the parking get into the class and drive home. There's like an accessibility piece that I think is really great. And the social anxiety piece for me personally was great. I mean, I found that I was able to get much deeper with my practice in the beginning for the first year of COVID as I took classes, because it just stripped away so many of the anxieties I had leaving my kids at home. And, you know, a couple times, you know, I mean, I sort of teach yoga for a living, so I would often be teaching at night and then taking classes at night. Always felt like kind of an abdication of my role, putting them to bed, stuff like that. So then just having them going to bed down the hallway while I was taking a class took me places in my practice that psychically I wasn't able to go before, but I'm a little maxed out on it now. Are you doing any online teaching?
All my classes are online.
Oh, they are. Okay. Gotcha. Yeah,
it's a double-edged sword. I mean, on the one hand, you can't make any useful adjustments unless you can get them to understand you verbally what to do. Right. And it's really hard to, some of the people don't show up on the screen. I always have to remind the who's ever out there to be careful. I can't see you, so I don't know what you're doing. Yeah. But on the other hand, I have students coming from all over the U.S. and England. So I have some English students.
That's great.
That gives them an opportunity to come take class.
Yeah, exactly. So I didn't know you had not gone back in person. Have you not? Why have you not gone?
No,
back
I'm in person. It's a hybrid class.
Gotcha.
There's a camera that I have a model. Mm-hmm. The camera's focused on the model, and so the people at home can follow the model.
Yeah, that makes it easier for you. The thing that yoga teachers, I think we all tend to say right now, is that teaching a hybrid class from a studio is pretty stressful, because you're looking at the students and you can't move away from the screen because you want them to be able to see you. But if you have a model, that takes care of that problem. Yes. And then do you just instruct to the ones that you see as often as you can?
I try to split my attention between the two, but unfortunately, I often get caught up in the people in the room, especially if it's a big class.
Yeah, totally.
And I sort of forget about the people online, but I try to do one group, the other side, the other group, and just encourage people that are online that they're doing well.
Mm-hmm. Totally. Do you think it's, do you prognosticate about where you think yoga might be going? Do you think about that sometimes? Do you think we're hybrids here to stay kind of a thing, or?
Oh, I'm definitely hybrids here to stay. I think it's going to become, it's become a thing now. Some people just really like it. Some people hate it. They won't. I have regular students that never show up online, but I have regular students, they roll out of bed, get their tea, wash their hair, and then they're online,
Totally.
And their cats are walking in front of them, the dogs and the kids. And, it's a real home experience.
Yeah. Yeah.
You get to see totally. What people's rooms look like.
Oh my gosh. Isn't that, for me, I took a slight, within the Iyengar yoga community, I don't know, I can't speak for all of, the Iyengar yoga teachers out there, but I think many, especially if they had relationships with their students, asked, please keep your cameras on. I put a blog post up. It had to have been 2020, where I took a picture of my practice space and like labeled it, like if I can see your space the way you can see this picture, then I'll be able to help you. I'll be able to teach you. I'll be able to, blah, blah, blah. And so people would use it and sort of use it as their marker. And, I feel like all the time I'm like, hey, can you tilt your camera down? Can you this, can you that? I mean, John Schumacher does that too. He really had assistants at the beginning of his classes, at the beginning of COVID, through COVID, get people to adjust their cameras. Like the assistants would be kind of chatting the students, the many, students in the class, to position their camera so that he could see them better. It was pretty amazing, actually. Yeah, I mean, that's like kind of next level, but that's definitely what I think some people out there are trying to do to give the students at home the most benefit possible. So do you think, I mean, you know, since you've written this one book, which is such a deep book about a practice, I love the naming of like cooperation with the breath instead of control of the breath. I think that's just awesome. And so you wrote it at that time because that's what you were thinking, or is there anything you're thinking about yoga going forward now that you want to talk about, that you're thinking about the yoga, you know, industry, the community, yoga teachers, now that you're this many years in to teaching?
I don't know. It's such a different world now than when I started. I mean, nobody knew what was going on in the yoga class, and now it's everywhere. It's in advertising. People are walking down the street with their mats rolled up on their back, and it's a completely different world. And that's a good thing, and it's not. Sometimes it's not such a good thing too, because, in the old days, we were very dedicated. Iyengar students are. They like punishment, so we go to class quite regularly.
Right.
But nowadays, it's an hour long class, an exercise class.
Max. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That just doesn't feel, I'm kind of an old fashioned guy in that way. I like hour and a half, 2 hour classes, mm-hmm. and it's just a different feel now, which is good in a way, because the more people that join in, the better it is. I mean, the more benefit it distributes, but I wish that, my students would be a little bit more, I shouldn't say this, but they should be a little bit more dedicated, I think, mm-hmm. to really make a difference in their lives.
Yeah, I was just going to say, what happens when you're not, as I thought you were going to say, committed. I mean, dedicated is, they're pretty similar words. But what do you think happens when there's less dedication to the practice? Is it just less benefit, or what is there?
Well, that depends on the person and how he or she or they are working the poses, mm-hmm. and whether it's benefit or not. But mm-hmm. I think I reviewed videos for Yoga Journal for 20 years or something like that, 15, 20 years. And what I saw in every video was that Shavasana was ignored or downgraded quite a bit. Mm-hmm. And so, that's one of the things that in my classes that's unusual, I think, because I do like 10, 12 minute Shavasanas at the end of the class. And I have that luxury because I have a 90 minute class. But I think, I think it's for a lot of people now, it's just in and out. They don't really have to take time to slow down and take a breath and look at themselves more fully.
Totally. Andrea told me, Ferretti, that she went to this class, and she loves the class, and she loves the teacher, and she loves the experience, and she's so glad she's back in the world taking class after being online. But at the end of the class, the teacher going into Shavasana, this is blows my mind. So I wonder what you think. Said, okay, you now is the last pose of class, Shavasana, or maybe he said corpse pose, who knows? And he said, so you're welcome to lie here if you want and relax, but you can also leave if you'd like. Mm. I'll be outside waiting for whenever you'd like to leave. So he left the class and left the students to choose whether, they should do Shavasana or not do Shavasana. And I was like, oh my gosh, that's total next level releasing of Shavasana from the class. Because, when I was early on, I took one of my first teacher trainings with Eric Schiffman, and he said, which is like such a great rubric. He was like, listen, at least 5 minutes for every hour, at least if there's an hour of practice, at least 5 minutes to Shavasana. And so that just always rings in my mind because,
Judas would say 5 minutes for every half hour.
Half hour. Oh, no way. Yeah. I love it. Yeah. I love it. half hour. Yeah. Yes. Well, and she's staying totally true to that with, when she and Lizzie came on to talk to me about, essentially what they're doing with the modern practice of restorative yoga, of which of course Shavasana is a key component. Right. So yeah, I appreciate that. I appreciate that kind of noting the Shavasana, the crisis of Shavasana. maybe we should call this podcast that, the crisis of Shavasana, because the more, if we were to do more of that, I think there would be more of a depth practice.
I have people online that cut out when Shavasana comes.
Oh, such a bummer. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I was going to ask actually, if we've gone from these like kind of rich, it doesn't feel that good to do a point counterpoint like, oh, it was so awesome when we were 90 minutes, 2 hours, and now it's so bad because it's so much more complex than that.
Yeah.
But if, let's just say, we have, as it is true that we have reduced the total amount of time that someone would be having in a yoga experience led by a teacher that we call a yoga class.
Yeah.
And therefore every pose potentially has less time to sort of marinate or, and therefore by the end of class, Shavasana, which typically is the longest pose you'll practice in a class, also gets shortened. How, I don't know how we get it back. I don't know how we can explore.
One of the things about Western yoga is it was designed, I think, purposely to make it harder. Mm. If you look at the old texts, there's no back bends, very few back bends in the old texts, and very few standing poses. They're mostly squats and sitting positions. Mm-hmm. And for Westerners, that would never work. Nobody would go to a class to sit in the squat for 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. And so Krishnamacharya, I don't know this for sure. This is just my own thinking, but he jazzed up the practice. He made it much more difficult. And that's what Westerners like. They want to be challenged, and they want to work, and they want to sweat. The problem is they also don't want to slow down to take a break. There's no balance between doing and not doing, which I think is really important. Mm-hmm. And I'm not quite sure how to get them to not do, but I try to convince my students in classes to not work so hard, to try easier.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's funny. I want to respect your time and thinking about like kind of closing it down with this thought. I wonder what you think about this. The reason I do this podcast is because during COVID, I had this opportunity to be exposed to so many different kinds of yoga practitioners all over the world who were during lockdown interested in some of the webinars that I was putting on with Satbir, Singh Khalsa, and some others. And my observation is that a huge amount of yoga practitioners are trending toward the not doing in the form of what things called like vinyasa, yin practice, restorative yoga, yoga nidra. There's a lot of practices that have gotten kind of elevated. Like the nap ministry she's not a yoga teacher, but she seems to have a huge, very intersectional or cross-sectional with a lot of yoga teachers, in which the sort of like genius of the nap, of relaxation, of stopping, is really making its way into yoga practice. So I wonder if we like sped it all up, made it really hard, and then something like COVID came and it just like screeched everything to a halt, and people are using yoga more now to rest. I don't know. Have you seen anything like that?
I can't say that I have. I don't really know. My students don't. My students are brainwashed now into doing their Shavasana, and
good.
They expect it. So, but you know, sometimes I get this, a new student says, that was a really good class, but do we have to do all that breathing at the end? Huh. And so, you know, I say, yes, you have to. And then I never see that person again. But that's what makes it so hard to predict what's going to happen with yoga over the next decades or century or whatever. It's just, you know, people are innovating so much and trying to find some new way to go that it's just really hard to predict what's going to happen over time.
Mm-hmm. That's, I think, a great place to end. I think it's really great in the not knowing, in the not knowing and the not doing and not sort of projecting our brains onto where things might be going. It'd be really cool to receive it and see. It was really great to talk to you after all these years, Richard. And I really hope that we do.
I really enjoyed that too.
Yeah, me too. And I hope that we get to see another book from you. And I hope that we can take this conversation someplace else the next time. I'm having some people come back on because so many things come up during the conversation. It would be great to see you again. Thanks for joining me today.
Thank you again, Kim.